Gentlemen, welcome to the show. Both of you are on the spot tonight.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Dr. Adam Mugume, let me begin with you. From your assessment, what is the economic situation in the country like? Is it a recession? What that could actually mean it is worse?
No, definitely it's not a recession. Because a recession means a negative growth, which means a contraction in economic activity for at least two consecutive quarters. So if in the financial year, the quarter one is a contraction followed by another contraction in the second quarter, then you qualify to be in a recession. So we saw a negative growth, a contraction in the first quarter of 2-1, which is the quarter ended September, was a contraction of minus 0.2. But largely driven by the agricultural sector, which were because of drought. So basically, if we get another negative growth or a contraction in the second quarter, then ideally, technically, would be qualified as in a recession.
But it's what you are, according to your definition, we're actually almost headed there. If quarter one we registered negative growth, this quarter where we are, everybody's feeling the pinch. We've seen the collapse of companies. We've seen the war in South Sudan. It appears from my angle that, Dr. Mugume, we're actually headed for recession.
Well, that's why I was saying that the first quarter, the biggest challenge was, as I said, was basically a contraction in agriculture. If you look at the numbers used by Uganda Bureau of Statistics, agriculture is the one that contracted severely in the first quarter. While the service and industry, the other subcomponents of our activity, industry grew actually, and then services. Remember, the services sector alone contributes a 51% of GDP, of economic activity. So that one never grew at all. It was flat. So basically, now the question is, will the second quarter be the same?
So again, on the service sector contributing 51% of the GDP, it's a very dangerous situation because only a small percentage of people are in the service sector. You have the biggest percentage of your population contributing less to the GDP. What kind of economy are we running?
Yeah, but you are forgetting that agriculture, the biggest problem I have been having is agriculture in terms of depending on, you know, on natural weather. Rainfall comes. If it comes too much, there's a problem. If it comes too little, there's a problem. So having nature controlling agricultural production is one of the is a big challenge. And I think the effort to go into irrigation aspect becomes instrumental. So overall, you are absolutely right. If 70% plus of our population is in agriculture and agriculture is contracting, then you are absolutely right. You are feeling the pinch. 70% of the population in agriculture is contracting. So yeah, this is a bit of a challenge. But that's why I was saying that that's the temporary phenomenon, because now that the rains are on, at least some of the agricultural production, we expect that actually agricultural production in the quarters ahead will gradually improve. But again, as I said, to really depend on weather as a method of generating income for 70% of the population, I think that's really where we have a big challenge.
Mr. Moses Bakabi, you are a macroeconomic advisor at the Minister of Finance. What could be the tangible interventions to save the situation?
I think first and foremost, there is a program of investing into infrastructure. We have been having a problem of low absorption and also efficiency issues in the sector. The government is investing in Karuma, Isimba, and other transport projects. Once those are completed, we're going to see acceleration in growth and also in employment.
But the Karuma project and the railway and Isimba, we are talking about 2020. So we are in this up to 2020?
No, there are some immediate actions required, which are short term, meaning that if we have issues to do with the distressed companies, for instance, the government has been paying domestic arrears. There has been a decision made to pay domestic arrears. In terms of agriculture, the ministry has been working out a strategy to make sure that we turn around the export growth in terms of coffee, tea, fish, and also horticulture. Those are immediate issues. And also dealing with the issues of South Sudan, for instance, the people who lost money there. And also ensuring that there is more money into development rather than consumption. That is also an immediate thing that we are dealing with. But also, most importantly, is to make sure that there is some bit of long-term finance to finance small, medium, and large-scale enterprises. So what we are doing there is to make sure that the government does reduces over the longer term, short and long term, reduces on domestic borrowing so that the private sector can grow, can be competitive and turn around the economy.
Recently, the Secretary of the Treasury, who I think is also the PS, the Minister of Finance, was quoted saying that as far as he was concerned, we are going to face this kind of economic squeeze or financial squeeze up to 2019. I don't know whether that was on the account of the infrastructure projects that the government has embarked on, but if that was the case, why would it be like that?
No, look at it this way. You have a five-year plan where you have development projects, some of those that are heavy infrastructure projects, the roads, the power, then you have the railway. All of them require a lot of resources. You have already committed to the extent that you don't want to commit any more in terms of borrowing to finance some of the extra projects. So that's, I think that's where it's coming from. That actually, you have committed to heavy projects in the next 5 years, and you also want to remember that you have to remain within your debt threshold. Otherwise, you are going to be in trouble with the debt problem. So after looking at all those scenarios, you have main drivers of economy in terms of infrastructure. You have already borrowed committed funds for those. The question is, where else do you get money to finance addition? I think that's where you are coming from, that actually, yeah, where the plan we have now is really already so exhaustive that we can't have room to continue expanding.
Moses, I've heard the whole idea of increasing local content in the projects that we have, roads, the sector, road sector, the dams and railway. But I'm wondering how that even can be done. What kind of local content do you put in the Karuma Power Dam? What kind of local content do you put in the standard gauge railway?
Actually, that is already ongoing. There has been a decision that has been made, and there has been discussions even at the highest level with the president and local manufacturers to make sure that Karuma, Isimba, and all these transport projects, they supply, the producers of steel actually supply those projects, cement, and also other local producers. So that is ongoing. What's going on right now is there is also an effort to amend the PPD law, because we have to do it within the law, and also they have put up guidelines to make sure that there is enforcement of the provisions of local content already in the legal framework. So that is already ongoing, and these efforts are going to be improved and accelerated. And as you know, the Ministry of Trade has been promoting what is called BUBU, Buy Uganda, Build Uganda, and that has been promoted and is being institutionalized.
Could you tell our viewers really what is it that we're producing so that we can buy? What are we producing so that we can go boo boo?
No, I think there are a number of things that we are producing, except that to be honest with you, I think some of the quality standards have been low. So that's why your government is putting in place
I can challenge you.
Yes.
That if
like
you
still
if you went down to the Constitutional Square on Saturday morning and that's the people running or moving around, and this is just an imagination, that whoever is not putting anything Ugandan on them, put it here, you'd see a sea of nakedness on Kampala, because everything we put on is imported.
No, I think
and
it's
just garments. Yeah. And yet if you go back in 1960, at least Ugandans were producing their own things. We were producing bales of cotton in Jinja. Busoga was producing more with even few people. Now producing less with so many people.
I think it starts with the change of attitude. Once government comes in and promotes these kind of things and talks about it like government is doing, Minister of Trade, the President and everyone, if you have your nation at heart, then you can start saying, let's do this. But that has to be said in as a coherent strategy of also promoting and supporting local producers. And there's an effort to do that and also to improve the standards of the things that we are producing.
Dr. Adam Ogome, the budget that we're running now, maybe if you could tell our viewers, what is the percentage of the money involved in servicing the debt? Because it appears there's a huge chunk that is supposed to service just the debt.
Well, I mean, interest payment, for example, for financial year 16-17, we're talking about around 2.2 trillion out of a budget of around 20 trillion. So that is substantial.
So we talk of a budget of 20 trillion, but and 2 point something is only paying interest.
So that's why I was saying,
we're borrowing more.
That's why I was saying that what PSST said was actually correct, fundamentally correct, that after looking at public investment needs, you have already committed resources, and you know very well the interest payment already that is actually becoming number one in terms of budget allocation, then you have to be careful in an additional...
Interest payment is now number three.
But
so Moses, is that healthy?
Let me just start by saying that a decision has been made to reduce domestic borrowing because the government appreciates the fact that this is too expensive. Okay, we've been borrowing 15-16% interest plus. It's too expensive. So the priority now is really to go to external borrowing, and especially concessional borrowing where it's available, except that concessional loans are still rare now, are becoming extremely rare. So much of it is going to be external borrowing, probably on commercial, but not too expensive loans. Of course, the ideal situation would have been financing this development through domestic resource mobilization taxes, okay? But our tax revenue is still low, and that turning around that situation is going to take a few years, maybe 2-3 years, until we reach the desired level of 15-18% of GDP. So, but right now what we are trying to do, which is a government decision, is to reduce domestic borrowing, and over time, this is going to happen. And when you look at where we were 3 years ago, we borrowed about 2.6% of GDP in terms of domestic borrowing. 2.6, but it has come down now to about 1.6, and it's going to continue coming down over the long term. So there is a deliberate effort, and this is also going to help the issue of private sector credit in terms of, you know, crowding out the private
sector.
Explain
to us, Dr. Mugume, what the problem that comes with domestic borrowing when the government gets involved, because for my understanding...
Let me finish this. What I was also going to say is that this domestic borrowing has been to support issues of things like compensation for projects, which are infrastructure projects, which are aimed at reducing the cost of borrowing, and also to cater for the government portion of donor funds, which is termed as usually called the counterpart funding. So because a decision has also been made not to start new projects, over the medium term, you'll see that the need for domestic borrowing is going to come down significantly. So what is going to happen is that over the longer term, over the medium to longer term, the issue of domestic borrowing is not going to be an issue anymore.
But what you have been doing was crowding out the other people who would have gotten money from the bank. I mean, the bank is happier giving money to the government than giving the money to me, because you will not default and they are guaranteed that they can get their money back in time.
So I think
I think that was an error of judgment. I think I've gone that angle.
No, I think the crowding out, governments all over the world, they borrow domestically. It's just the level. The problem we have here is government goes into the market. If it's excessive borrowing, you know, interest rates go up, but the quantity of the funds available is still adequate in the economy, except that it becomes a little bit more expensive. But we are dealing with that issue.
And that's why I have to ask Dr. Mugume, why is it that it is expensive to borrow internally? You put the CBR at a certain level, but then the interest rates go high. And I wonder.
No, but think about it. You have already answered the question. The big brother government
is borrowing from the same.
17%. For 1 year. Now it has come down slightly to around 14%. Idea, remember, you have already said that is risk-free. So if Adam is going to borrow from a commercial bank, the bank will say, should I give it to Adam at what rate compared to the government? Government will pay 14 per year, and there is no risk. You give it to Adam, I will take the money, but at risk. So the risk, therefore, depends on how is Adam risky. So if I'm a person whose activity is very risky, then they put that in some activities 10%, So you add it to 14, you go to 24%. So really that's way. So the way the government borrows at what rate becomes instrumental when the bank is deciding which portfolio should I hold the money. Remember, the bank also is dealing with depositors' money. So basically, that's the judgment.
So why would the government compete with its people to that extent? Up the level of making it hard for them to do business.
Let me say this.
If you have interest rates at 25%, you have electricity tariffs maybe at high, you also have other costs of production, then no wonder you're going to have non-performing loans.
No, but think about it. If there was no power, remember the government is borrowing to put into infrastructure. Imagine if the government doesn't provide power, which power has to be provided by the same borrowing. The question is, so the judgment will come, so which is the better evil? Should I crowd out straight the private sector and provide power, or I leave the power for people to use the generator the way we used to do it before, and therefore I borrow less? So it really becomes a trade-off. What do I do?
Exim Bank of China.
Now, the Exim Bank is not easily a better alternative either. Sometimes, well, it is now when they are giving concessional terms, but supposing it is commercial. Remember that if you borrow at commercial, countries that have borrowed commercial, including Ghana, at 10%, you put on exchange rate depreciation. If it becomes 10, automatically you're also talking about borrowing 20%. So the only problem, the advantage is that you have a collateral private sector, but still you have to get the money from the same private guys we're talking about to pay back the 20%.
Dr. Mugume, hold on to your point, because we're going to take a break. When you come back, I'll be asking on the slowdown of investor confidence in Uganda and how can we reboot that confidence of investors. We'll be right back. Welcome back. You're watching On The Spot. My name is Patrick Amara, and my guest tonight is Dr. Adam Mugume, Director of Research at Bank of Uganda, and Mr. Moses Tabakabi, a macroeconomics advisor at the Ministry of Finance. We have seen a slowdown of investor confidence in the economy. How do we reboot that, Moses?
First and foremost, let me say that for the last 6 months up to December, investor confidence has turned around. It's positive. When you look at the business index, tendencies index, it's 55.2%, I think, by December 2016. So it's been positive. Once it reaches 50 and above, then it is regarded as positive. So to say that investor confidence is not collapsing, it's actually improving. But going back to the issue of confidence, I think once government is consistent with what we are doing, like in terms of policy, in terms of investment, and in terms of modernizing the legal framework and ensuring that there is a rule of law, there is no preferential treatment, there is fair treatment for all, investor confidence is going to come back. And when you look at the numbers, really, even if the economy is growing 4.5%, next year is going to be 5.5%. When you look at the confidence of the private sector, you see a positive trend, not a negative one.
I've heard that if we are to really hit the much voted middle income status by 2020, then Dr. Adam Mugume, some people can say we need to grow the economy maybe in double digits, but Moses is saying we're growing at 4.something%. Is that the kind of growth that can take us to the middle income status in the next 3 years?
Well, we are now at GDP per capita in terms of dollars, we are basically around 670. We need $1,030 per capita
to enter that
to status. Enter that there. Now, GDP has to grow faster. That's a fact. But also, it automatically means that the shilling exchange rate vis-a-vis the dollar has to at least either appreciate or remain stable. Because even if you grow very fast and the shilling depreciates very fast equally, then you won't reach there. Remember that actually we had almost hit $800 per capita when exchange rate was in the range of 2,000 something. But because of the fast depreciation, then also the per capita in terms of dollar decline. So the two therefore, you have to grow the economy very fast, but you also have to grow things that you can export to generate more dollars, so that at least your shilling remains stable in that direction. Now, the 4.5% growth cannot make us reach there. Ideally, I mean, you see that it can't. You need at least a growth in the range of 7%. Is it attainable in the case of Uganda? The answer is yes, provided what Moses was saying, we do what exactly the government is trying to do: improve public investment, invest in agriculture, make power that is stable and relatively cheap, support manufacturing. All those combined together, that's where you can reach there.
One thing you just talked about is invest in agriculture, and when I look again in the budget, I find a paltry, small amount of money put in agriculture, even though sometimes I do not want to hound you much as government, because the same ministry at some point has returned the money, the little that has been given, due to lack of absorption capacity. So sometimes I'm forced to eat my humble pie when I'm saying put a lot, and at the end of the year, even the little they have put, it's returned.
Yeah. Before I go to that, I just want to add to what Adam has said, is to say that the middle income status is within a medium term is achievable. Because if you complete the investment that we are doing, if we have oil coming out by 2020, and you have all these other things happening, then you can actually achieve a middle income status. Going back to
you can achieve it in terms of hitting the target whereby you just have a few people who have amassed a lot of wealth, you know, and then you make a calculation to say, yes, we have reached that level. But in real meaning, in reality, people are wallowing in poverty. That can happen. Is that what you're meaning?
Well, that can happen, but there are a number of...
But isn't that what we are likely to see?
No. There are a number of things that are happening, because the investments that are being done, well, of course, there is the emphasis in infrastructure, but also there is a renewed emphasis on agriculture, where most of our people are, in fact, where they're employed, improving productivity and production, especially in the key areas where people are employed: tea, coffee, fish, horticulture. All those things are going to be giving priority in the budget. The budget is giving priority to, affordable irrigation, but also the government is going to be thinking about how to develop, investing in bulk water on rivers and lakes to address the issues of climate change, and also to provide, water for production. So that is going to happen very soon.
Government has often said that money accrued from the oil will not be spent wastefully. But now I was reading the other day that Parliament is saying more than ₦1 trillion. ₹1 trillion cannot be accounted for. I mean, Director of Research at Central Bank, what do you make of this?
No, I think those are exaggerations. And remember,
the Parliament is exaggerating.
No, I think it is a question of also clear understanding that actually the money we are talking about was put into infrastructure investment, and if you follow the trail of how the money was, where it went, it is part of the Karuma we are talking about and the Simba as part of the payments for those projects. So there is no money.
Are you telling us that the Parliament, the 10th Parliament of Uganda, has not done its oversight role to actually follow the money and know where it is?
No,
when they say it has not been accounted for, they do not know.
I think the question was when I never followed exactly what the Parliament said, but the question was when the PFM law was passed in 2015. By then, there was no petroleum fund. The monies were being put into oil and some other holding accounts. So the question, by that time, Karuma and Simba had started. So you had already spent some of the money. So because the petroleum fund was not yet created, the question, therefore, I think what there has been a debate was how much was put into the petroleum fund when actually the law was passed. It is not a question that actually the money got lost.
Okay.
Moses,
let's turn again into this agriculture sector. Today I was thinking that if Uganda which has half of East Africa's arable land that is here. We have more fresh water and rivers than any other country I know on this continent, and fertile soil than any country that I know. If we put our act together and produced food here, all our neighbors around us, we could actually produce so much that they find it even expensive for them to go into agriculture.
That's true.
And then they just keep buying from us. So why don't we just put our act together, I mean, get on our comparative advantage, produce so much that even Kenya and Tanzania and Rwanda will say, we just can't compete. We have the water, we have the arable land, we have fertility. We can do this.
Yeah, the Minister of Finance has been doing an assessment on what can be done to turn around agriculture. And we realized that in the Ministry of Finance that one of the key things is that the inputs that have been going into agriculture through the various institutions, Operation Wealth Creation, UCDA, and all those kind of things, has been of a low quality. So the mortality has been too high. But secondly, so we are addressing that. Secondly, is the issue of limited coordination between the institutions delivering on this, the PMA, the UCDA, Operation Wealth Creation, and so on. So a framework is being created to make sure that there is effectiveness in terms of the delivery.
So when you start something and then you realize that what you're doing is of a low quality, was that a try and error?
No, it wasn't.
Was that a pilot of sorts?
No, it wasn't try and error. But this is an issue that is, has been highlighted, and we are addressing it. The second thing that we are trying to do is to make sure that there is a linkage between the large farmers, the ones that have money, they have the skills, they can do research, linking them with the small farmers, okay? And so that there is some knowledge flowing from the big to the small, and also accessing markets, so that the big farmers can help the small ones access the markets. So those are some of the things that are being done. There's also some zoning, mm-hmm. So that specific commodity farmers, nucleus farmers, are linked to farmer groups in order to, you know, to make sure that the delivery mechanism for imports, access to finance, and extension services is much more effective.
You know what is interesting, Mr. Bakai, is that you sound so convincing,
yes.
On paper. And all these good things are glorious, the plans and everything, but when it comes to implementation, it doesn't come out.
Again, implementation has been an issue and is one of the issues that we've been looking at. That's why we are looking at institutions and Ministry of Finance, because of some of the institutional weaknesses in some other departments, and because of the planning role of the Ministry of Finance as well, is to take a lead role in trying to make sure that there is enforcement of these things. So there is added effort now in trying to ensure that there is implementation of these things that we are talking about, and that's why the ministries now are required, all the ministries and government agencies, in terms of the budgeting, are required to produce a strategic plan with clear action plans on actions on what is going to be done, which are going to be monitored.
And I'm pretty sure the plan will come out and it will be superb.
Yeah, there will be various
plans. But again,
plans.
On the altar of implementation, it will fail flat. But Dr. Adam Ngome, in agriculture itself, you find we have 40% post-harvest loss. How do you bring it down? Because if people are losing 40% of their produce after harvest, then that's a serious issue.
No, I think in my own assessment, the agricultural sector sometimes is taken as a residue, in the sense that it is only when we come to a crisis that we remember that agriculture is actually should be the mainstay. For example, we are talking about growth of 4.5. The quickest way to generate high growth in the case of Uganda is just agriculture. Think about it. In 2016 and 15, we exported maize and beans, $200 million. And next to coffee, it was actually maize and beans because we had a good harvest in 2015. But this year alone, towards the end of 2016, we had a sharp decline. Now we're talking about half of that coming to reality. So therefore, the question of exporting, the question of production in the two commodities alone, maize and beans, can really help you to do some of the things that, and you are absolutely right, some of those exports went into Kenya. Mm-hmm. as you know, and also part of some of the neighboring countries. So overall, I agree with you that to handle agriculture in a wholesale, deal with post-harvest losses, deal with poor land mechanisms, including the lack of use of fertilizer,
and the tenure system.
The land tenure system. So as a whole, because I think sometimes we tend to think that having industry, sorry, service as a big percentage of GDP is a sign of transformation, which is, if you have ever done economics, there were those stages of growth that, you know, when you are at starting stage, you are predominant agriculture. So as you move toward the service as a share of GDP, then you are transforming. Now, taking the economic development in that perspective is really wrong. It's not a sincere way of looking at economics. So the question is, how do you transform agriculture to make sure that the inputs, as Bekabio was saying, are delivered in time? If it is fertilizers, they are used, the land tenure system, the post-harvest losses you're talking about, as a wholesale, the way farmers store. By the way, if a farmer knows that he's going to get money from a particular commodity, you give him an idea on how to handle some of those. Provided he knows he's going to get money from it, the farmer will do it.
Yes.
And I think it is a question of integrating those interventions in a systematic way, knowing that it is not inputs alone that will matter. It is also the way the farmer will handle what he's planting, how he's going to harvest it, the storage, the marketing system, as an integrated approach. Mm. It is really not one single aspect that will, you know, that will solve the problem.
But also the seed multiplication by the government
research.
Should
the
be
research.
A serious strategy.
Yeah.
It's not somebody should not just go to a window market and you buy grain there, which is meant for food. Maybe somebody, you know, puts it in some color and you take it and to plant and doesn't germinate.
Mm. Yeah.
There should be a serious government
That's
strategy
true.
For seed multiplication.
Yeah.
Yes, I think government is looking at that, and they are looking at the institutional framework for that, ensuring that the standard is for the seeds is quality seeds. So that way you plant it, it germinates, and then it's high yielding. So these are some of the areas where we're looking at more seriously in the Ministry of Finance. In terms of storage, the one I agree with Adam what he said. Government is also partnering with the private sector to make sure that there are post-harvest storage systems in place. And also we are working very closely with the private sector on what we call a warehouse receipt system.
Yeah.
Which is also going to help in reducing, you know, post-harvest losses.
Do you realize that actually going back to the system that Uganda used to have 40, 50 years ago?
I agree with you.
Well,
and you wonder, why did we leave a winning formula for Uganda? If it could win for us 30, 40 years ago, why did we abandon it?
But you remember, in 30, 40 years, when I was a kid, there was a village chief who would come monitoring villages.
So village chiefs are no longer there?
The village chiefs will come look at your chitara, whether it is constructed to store food which you have harvested for almost a season plus. He will first check. Remember that if a village chief will find that actually your granary was poor, there was also a question of graduated tax. But
Mr. Dr. Mugume,
yeah.
Are you suggesting we no longer have leaders?
No. The problem
because
was...
Because that's a leadership issue.
No, the
right
question there. Was, when we liberalized, we thought that everybody will now produce my maize, cash it out, keep the money in the bank, and therefore when I need medicine or food, I know I have the money. And therefore the food security system came in on board. So the question is how to integrate the beauty with liberalization, the beauty with... Not the village chief who will come with a stick or imprisonment, but with incentives to help the farmers to do what they're supposed to do. Basically, that's what we're talking about. But the reality, I agree with you that we are turning around to know that actually greeneries that we used to have in older, in our generations, some years back, actually, were helpful in terms of storing food.
Dr. Mugume, we're going to take a break. When we come back, I'll be opening the line so that you two at home, or wherever you are, you can contribute to this discussion, maybe ask a question, and also be looking at how maybe we can diversify Uganda's economy, maybe look into the tourism sector, because it looks like Uganda's tourism potential is enormous. We'll be right back. Welcome back. You're watching On the Spot. My name is Patrick Amara, and my guest tonight is Dr. Adam Ogume, Director of Research at Bank of Uganda, and Mr. Moses Bakabye from the Ministry of Finance, Macroeconomic Advisor. Moses, isn't it high time that we diversified Uganda's economy? Look into the tourism sector. The other day, in 2012, Lonely Planet voted Uganda the number one tourist destination. Just this year alone, we again voted, I think, number four place to visit. So if the 7 billion people of the world think us we're the number one, we're the ideal place for where Ugandan people who have money can come and visit, then that is the place where the money should be invested, and then we can have the dividends.
I think you're correct. Tourism has a very huge potential for this economy. I also want to say that I think the biggest problem we are facing today is an issue of organization, you know, because everywhere you look, agriculture, tourism, and many other areas, the potential is huge if we can be that organized. So what we are trying to do at the Ministry of Finance in the tourism sector is to ensure that the infrastructure around tourism is improved, and the government is putting significant money in hospitality, improving all these areas in order to harness this potential in tourism sector. So it's being given priority in the budget, this budget, and also in the coming budget.
Okay, again, you're doing something right, but after a lot of time, after missing so many opportunities.
That's correct.
How about starting some kind of an agricultural bank, so that maybe farmers can borrow at a lower interest rate, and we know that this specifically will handle the farmers. Will that create some unhealthy competition in the liberalized market, Dr. Mogumi?
No, I think it's a question of trying now to give preferential treatment to a particular sector.
Can you do that?
Well, no. We as if the government decides, for example, that's why we started agriculture, facility with Minister of Finance, where
agriculture credit facility.
A facility.
But who is taking advantage of SCF?
No, it is quite a number of borrowers, and that is determined by commercial banks. You are priced through a commercial bank, you are assessed, and then the money is given to you. And actually, now it is really being tried to be extended.
Yeah, but you see, when you bring such a vehicle, like the agricultural credit facility, right? Credit facility, then you would have at least gone full throttle and start an agriculture bank.
No, the question is setting up a bank that is 100% oriented to that particular sector. It can be very risky.
In what sense?
Because remember that. If you look at you were talking about drought, the biggest number of non-performing loans are in agriculture, in the case of the banking system. Remember that our non-performing loans now, we are talking about 10.5%.
But then why should agriculture be nature best?
That's the problem. Now, if you only look at financing, that's why I was talking about an integrated system. You have financing, you have the marketing, you have the production, you have the handling. So that is taken as an integrated approach. But if we only use finance and then drought comes, then you reduce the
market. What the countries that have succeeded in agriculture, in fact, if you go to Egypt, we just give them water, they are doing much better. I've even bought Egyptian juice that is being sold in Kampala. You wonder, they live in a desert. You go further north in Israel, very small country, tiny, living on rocks of sorts. They're producing. So sometimes it's about a little bit of water and a lot of ideas. We have a lot of water, and are we lacking ideas?
I think what we are trying to do, before I come to the water issue, I think in terms of finance, agriculture finance, what we are trying to do as government and the Ministry of Finance is to implement what we are calling the agriculture insurance. And also we are right now at a discussion stage on a partial risk guarantee facility for agriculture.
What does that mean?
What it means is that it provides a framework where the banks, the farmer, and all the stakeholders involved share the risk. In other words, it underwrites the risk. It reduces the risk for banks to lend to agriculture. That's a much more sustainable way of doing it rather than creating an agriculture bank. In terms of Egypt, comparing Egypt and Uganda, Yes, I think we can move in the Egypt direction. Mm-hmm. And that's what I mentioned before. We are looking at simple, affordable irrigation, but also thinking about bulk irrigation on rivers and lakes, so that we can actually popularize and promote irrigation.
Let me involve those of Ugandans who have been following us tonight. So I'm going to open the lines right now so that we can have you contribute to this discussion, how we can maybe make our economic situation better. I'm taking the very first caller online. Hello?
Yes, hi.
Good evening, sir. What's your name and where are you calling from?
My name is Hood.
I'm sorry, sir.
And my name is Hood.
Okay, Hood. Go right ahead, sir.
Yes, I'm a graduate student in Rwanda, but I'm Ugandan. Okay. So I would like to ask those gentlemen something. Thank you for the insights that you've been giving us. However, hello?
Yes, continue. You're on air. Do not listen to yourself. Just keep talking, sir.
Yeah, okay. Now, the thing is that we've seen so many governments having an open data policy on some of the projects that they are undertaking, the government expenditure and all that. Now, the thing is with Uganda is that we don't have any sort of that open data policy. So what's happening is that the government is doing all these projects or whatever prospects that they are doing, but they have no visibility of some of the things that are happening down there. Now, for example, these gentlemen are throwing out numbers. We are moving at a 4% of, whatever number they are throwing out, but they have no evidence. If you check the Bank of Uganda website and maybe even the Ministry of Finance website, you will not find any publicly available data. So how are they going to, if they are talking about attracting investors to come to Uganda, how are they going to attract the investors when the investors themselves have no way of proving that the money they're investing in Uganda will be able to make a profit?
Thank you very much.
How are they?
Thank you very much. Your name again, sir, and where are you calling from? Okay. All right, let me take some other callers online. I suppose you picked that question, and you'll be responding to that gentleman. Let me take another call online. Hello.
Hello.
Good evening, sir. What's your name and where are you calling from?
My name is Kurong. I'm calling from Mukono.
Mukono, your name is Colin.
Now, whereas it's clearly visible, the economy is shrinking. I would look at some of the policies being introduced. Are you hearing me? We look at some of the policies being introduced, for example, meant to discourage production, domestic production, for example, taxation. A case in hand, for example, the tax withheld at point of importation for manufacturers who are specifically trying to probably revamp the economy. Now, can't we use, despite we wanting to collect some money for government to use, can't we use a friendly taxation policy such that maybe it can boost up domestic production? Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Our caller there from Mukono. Let me take two more callers online. Hello? And let me ask my producer to turn up the volume a little bit in the studio here so that my guests can hear. Hello? Hello, I have a call online. Hello. Let me try another call online. Hello. Hello. Okay, I think I'll maybe answer those two. Then we can get back to those callers later. We have a technical hitch.
No, the first caller said that there are no numbers is not basically true. Mm-hmm. You just go to Bank of Uganda website, we periodically put them there, all the numbers that are really required. So, and actually, I think Uganda is one of the countries where you have a lot of data on the website. Yeah. Uganda Bureau of Statistics has a lot of data. Bank of Uganda website has a lot of data. So Minister of Finance, to the extent that even they give you the data on the budget allocation, who got the money and who never, you know, in which percentage, all that information is really available. So that's really not true that we don't provide information.
In addition to the websites, the Minister of Finance, especially the budgetary data, is published in newspapers on a quarterly basis. Yeah. So.
Okay. Let me take maybe two more callers and that will be it. Hello. Let me try just one caller. Hello. Hello. Okay. All right. So we have since in this discussion, I've just realized. Hello.
Hello, comrade.
Good evening, sir. What's your name and where are you calling from?
My name is Joseph Bipipe, calling from Entebbe.
From Entebbe?
Yes.
Go right ahead, sir.
Dr. Mugume, even in agriculture, we need to zero in on an item that the whole world needs that we can produce with an advantage. Maybe we could look at coffee. Why don't we bring in all these elements, the Starbucks of this world, and make sure that we are developing this sector, employing millions of Ugandans, and taking advantage, really, of something where we have a comparative advantage. Thank you very much.
Okay. Yeah. On that one, we are dealing with four items. One is coffee, because we realize we can actually produce much more coffee than we are doing now. You know, learning from the
but you know, you need really water and a lot of it.
Yes, we need
coffee.
Yeah.
So you have to go away from the rain-fed agriculture if you have to put your act together well.
As Adam said, we are having an integrated approach to these things. Then we are looking at tea, and then we are looking at fish. Fish has a lot of potential, and then horticulture. Horticulture in terms of chilies, Scotch bonnet, and all those kind of things. So those are the things that we are looking at, four things in terms of agriculture.
Okay. Let me take another call online, and then my guest will have concluding remarks on this show tonight. Hello? Hello? I have a call online. Hello?
Hello.
Good evening, Michael. Sir. What's your name and where are you calling from?
My name is Michael, calling from Nasala.
Yes, Michael. You're on air, sir.
Yes. My name is Michael. Yes. I have only one concern. Bank of Uganda has failed to regulate the interest rates.
Okay, it's that simple. Go for it.
I think we have been on spot saying money is like any commodity. If you don't regulate price for matoke or beans, why should you regulate a price for money? And I think the minister also has been on spot for that. The question is, think about a country that tried to do... Actually, we were there before. In the 1980s, we were there, and we knew the consequences. That actually, nobody put money in the bank when we tried to do that. A country that has done it already, the GDP is slashed by 0.4% for this year alone, because the consequences are there. You know, it becomes very expensive because you are trying to fix a price for a commodity, again, whose demand and supply you are not fixing. I think really that's where you're coming from. So the question is, how do you instead make financial system more efficient in terms of mobilizing resources cheaply, massively, and also trying to intermediate them in a particular sector that give you a better return?
Yeah, I think his concern is high interest rates, and what we are doing very quickly in this is we are pursuing reforms in the pension sector to make sure that there is development finance coming from mobilization of private savings. What we're also doing is reducing the operational costs of banks so that the cost of borrowing is reduced a bit, but also what we're also trying to do, as I said before, is to reduce on domestic borrowing so that interest rates can actually come down.
Okay, Moses, in a few seconds, you are parting shot tonight on the show.
Well, my parting shot is to say that the economy is not in a hopeless situation. This has been slow growth compared to previous years, but the government is dealing with that situation. and there's no need for panicking. The economy is not in recession. We can see that there are some positive trends over the last 6 months. So there is hope for the best.
Dr. Adam Ogume, your concluding remark tonight.
I think, as Moses said, the economy is not crashing. The economy is only that we went into a rough year because of different, global developments and also the domestic. So we hopefully, in the remaining part of this year, we're likely to see activity coming, recovering. There are still challenges here and there, but we believe that actually we are on the positive trend.
Dr. Adam Mugume, Director of Research at Central Bank, thank you very much for your time.
Thank
Mr.
You.
Moses Bakabie, Macroeconomic Advisor at the Ministry of Finance, thank you very much for having added value to our discussion tonight, and you who have been a part of this. Good night, and
okay.
God bless Uganda.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you.